I'm back and I'm still cool.
Tough luck, kid. Still cool.
Today, we're talking about what I consider to be one of the greatest rebrands in history.
So good, you probably don't even know what happened.
You stupid fucking idiot. You don't even pay attention, do you?
Open your eyes.
Listen, there's a whole world around you happening. You have to watch.
What is it being born before the year 1970 that makes people talk like that?
Anyway, today we will be discussing how Carmen was crowned into Her Majesty Queen Herbie.
Carmen? What do you mean? You mean this Carmen?
Yes, that's exactly the Carmen I mean. In the early 2010s, there was a pop duo named Carmen, K-A-R-M-I-N.
It consisted of Amy and Nick. They were partners. They have now since become husband and wife, but at the time they were just two little college babies falling in love.
Actually, they went to my alma mater, the Berklee College of Music. Amy was a voice principal. Nick was a trombone principal.
How did they become pop superstars?
They never really did, but like we'll use that term for now. How did they become relatively well-known pop music makers? Well, in 2012, they started posting these covers on YouTube of like particularly rap songs where Nick was playing the instrumentals and Amy was doing her thing with the microphone.
Hey, Mr. Tallyman, tally me banana. Daylight come and me won't go home. Me say day, oh. Daylight come and me won't go home.
6 foot, 7 foot, 8 foot punch.
And given the timing that they started posting these were some of the first super viral, like, music-esque videos on YouTube. Not music videos, but, like, covers. These were some of the first covers to ever go viral. There it is. Jesus Christ. Specifically, their cover of Look At Me Now.
Yellow model chick, yellow bottle sipping, yellow Lamborghini, yellow top missing. Yup, yup, that stuff looked like a toupee. I get what you get in 10 years, in 2 days.
As we sit here today, it has 114 million views. They performed this on The Ellen Show. And then their covers just began to take off every single time they posted them. So now they've got a YouTube audience, they've got people listening, they've got a global audience, thank you to Miss Ellen DeGeneres. So what do? They get signed to a record deal. Of course they do, of course they do. And on May 4th, 2012, they released their debut EP. Hello, hi, how are you? So you'd think with the YouTube of it all, with the Ellen of it all, this EP would have gone home run straight to the fucking back of the field. How do you play baseball? But nope. Oh God, no. Ooh, baby girl, this was bad. Like, just objectively bad music. It was not good. In fact, Miss Jody Rosen of the Rolling Stone dubbed it, quote, one of the most aggressively obnoxious debut albums in recent memory. And then doubled down by saying, Heidemann's daffiness and horrendous rapping spoil the broth every time. Whoa. The publication Rolling Stone itself rated the debut as a 2.5 star out of 5 star release, and Metacritic rated it a 43 out of 100. So, you know, failing grades. We would have to be retaking this class. But, and it's a big but, there was something special on this debut. There was a song on this called Broken Hearted.
I'm here in a sticky situation, got a little trouble, yep, and now I'm pacing. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, now it's been an hour. Don't wanna think too hard, but I'm sour. Oh, oh, I can't seem to let you go.
And when they released this as a single, it did the exact opposite of what the fucking rest of the EP did, and it soared. It debuted at number 18 on the Billboard Hot 200, even with all the hatred coming from Miss Jody at Rolling Stone. And the other single that came from the EP was called Hello, and it also did relatively well. And what's crazy, side note that has nothing to do with literally any of the rest of this video, is Hello, the single, not the EP, Hello, the single from this album, Hello, samples Nirvana's Smells Like Teen Spirit.
Hello, 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 hello.
How did they do that on their debut What? Anyway, back to Broken Hearted. Certified platinum, peaked at number 16 on the Billboard Hot 100, and now is considered easily one of the classic songs from the early 2010s, which if you ask me, nostalgia is what's gonna pay your bills. So 2012 was probably a weirdly bittersweet year for Amy and Nick of Carmen, because they had this major global success with just one piece of this thing that they had just worked very hard for, and they weren't able to show any of the receipts because what they did on YouTube was so completely different than what the music they had just released. It was a mess, to say the least. So then 2012 goes by, 2013 goes by, 2014 starts to creep up into spring, and we don't have a debut album from them. We have an EP, and that's it. And it's an EP nobody fucking likes. So finally, in March of 2014, 2 years after the release of their first EP, 2 years after the wave of Broken Hearted had already soared well beyond back into the ocean, they released their debut album, Pulses. I'm gonna hold your hand, and we're gonna walk down memory lane together, okay? Because they're... Oh my God, it's so bad. And not the music, the timing. Because what was going on March 2014 in the music charts? Heart Attack by Demi Lovato, Get Lucky, the Grammy Award winning song by Daft Punk, Counting Stars by One Republic and the billions of streams it went on to receive, Wrecking Ball by Miley Cyrus, her first step into the ever so scandalous idea of showing some shoulder, Roar by Katy Perry, which has gone on to become one of her fucking classic hits, and Best Song Ever by One Direction. Hey, do you guys want to listen to some Carmen? Yeah, I didn't think so. You probably won't be surprised to learn that it didn't produce a hit. It didn't even come close to producing something like Broken Hearted. There's a song off the album called Acapella that did relatively well in Australia and New Zealand. You and me are through though, watch me hit it solo. I'ma do it acapella, yeah. But that's a pretty small market, and they have Pink. They're doing okay. They don't need another pop star, I don't think. So in the end of 2014, after the release of this album and their little tour that they did with it, they dropped from their record deal. They were like, you know what? We're cool. Thank you so much for everything. Kisses and hugs. And when they announced that they were leaving Epic Records, this is what they told Billboard magazine. We were hungry to try a more musically honest approach. We wanted to be a little bit nerdier than we think they had hoped. And nerdy did they become. On September 9th, 2016, Carmen released what would be their last record, called Leo Rising. In preparation for this album, they said that they really consistently met with an astrologist, and the whole theme behind this record is that each of the 12 songs go with each of the 12 zodiac signs, one for each sign. Those songs and their corresponding signs being Dance With You, Aries, Sugar, Taurus, Didn't Know You, Gemini, No Suitcase, Cancer, Come With Me, Pure Imagination, Leo, Everything, Virgo, Along the Road, Libra, Can't Live, Scorpio, That's Me, Blame It on My Heart, Sagittarius, Save Me Now, Capricorn, Easy Money, Aquarius, I Got You, Pisces. And the album made no waves. No big money moves, no Broken Hearted, no hits, no radio play, nothing like that. But for me personally, I was ready to dive in and eat and swim through the fucking waters of Leo Rising. And I did. I still really like that album. But that was it. That was the nail in the coffin, I think, for Miss Carmen. And then 2017 came and something happened. All of Carmen's socials were wiped clean and they uploaded a video and the only thing it said was, Carmen is dead. Long live the queen. What? And then nearly immediately after doing that, Amy announced her solo endeavor, Queen Herbie. People ask me all the time, how you doing that, Busta Rhymes? Carmen and Queen Herbie are the same people. The music video for Queen Herbie's Busta Rhymes debuted on June 1st, 2017, and then the debut of her debut EP, EP 1, released the following day. And when it was released, people really, really enjoyed it. And there was a very, very valid criticism that this was considered, to some, musical blackface. I mean, it's relatively clear to me why people would say something like that. Because when you look at her performing as the artist formerly known as Carmen, she didn't have that certain affectation to her voice. And I think in more recent releases, now that she's settled into who Queen Herbie is, I think she's given a little bit of that up. But again, that's not for me to decide. My job is to just let you know that that was what was said. So following the release of EP 1, Queen Herbie went on to release a series of just EPs, EPs 1 through 9. And there were a few other releases sprinkled in here and there, but mostly it's been EP after EP after EP. Usually they have like 5 to 8 or 9 songs. So in order to date, we've had the release of EPs 1 through 6, and then she released something called the Vignettes. Then after EP 7, we got the release of Tiny Piano. After EP 9, we got Hello Queen. And since EP 9, we've received Mad Queen, The Muse, and Housewife. In the era of Queen Herbie, as she's come into her own and grown into an artist, she's become somewhat of a social media star. She's gained millions and millions of followers, received hundreds of millions of views, I'm sure, across TikTok, YouTube, Instagram. So it's fair to say these two know how to market themselves, and they make obviously a great pair. They fucking married each other, but they also make a great pair business-wise. Her husband, Nick, instead of being in the act with her, is her producer, her main producer.
Do you want to just do a harmony and not a double, or you want to just
do it? I do. Technically, she does it well. Technically, she
does it well. Yes, just like that.
And I think visually, she's got a really clear aesthetic going on. When you look at just stills and look at colors and look at the aesthetics of something that she does, it's like, oh yeah, that makes sense. That looks like a Queen Herbie video. That sounds like a Queen Herbie song. I don't know what to tell you what I think she's gonna do next, because I think she's just gonna keep releasing EPs and doing some maybe more album works, more singles, more features. But if you like that sort of style of rap, trap, and hip-hop music, I say give it a go. I think some of her music is really good. I used to listen to a lot of Queen Herbie's music in college. In my 2024 playlist, I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 Queen Herbie songs, and they are Sade in the 90s, Living the Dream, Beautiful, Pray for Me, featuring Farrah Fox, BDE, Vitamins, Holiday, and Wifey. You'll notice I love a hook. I love a little something to sing along to. And that's where I get my fix. Let me know, did you know Carmen became Queen Herbie? Did you know of Queen Herbie? And did you know that she was also Carmen? Also, definitely go listen to Leo Rising. It's very good pop music. It's not crazy like Taylor Swift pop, like bubblegum pop. It's refined, it's pulled back. And it's, again, I'm gonna say this until the end of time. It's thought out and it's thought through, and it's a very well composed, through composed piece of music. You should go give it a listen. So there is your homework. Did you know who Queen Herbie was? If you knew who Queen Herbie was, did you know that she was Carmen? Did you know of Carmen? You know how to answer questions. While you're leaving a comment below, don't forget to like and subscribe. Also, if you liked this video, buy me a coffee. It's in the description.
I'm trying to move out of this house.
Thanks for spending your Monday with me. I'll see you on Friday, but in the meantime, if you would like to find me anywhere else, literally everywhere else, I'm Cody Jacob.